Good evening, everyone. I'd like to welcome everyone to the July 26th special City Council and Planning Commission meeting. Tonight, we're all in for a great treat. We'll be talking about the history of Temple City. Madam Clerk, could you take a roll call, please?
Councilmember Blue?
Here.
Councilmember Chavez?
Here.
Councilmember Vizcarra?
Here.
Mayor Pro Tem Sternquist?
Here.
Mayor Hugh?
Here. And then a Planning Commission?
Commissioner Curran?
Here.
Commissioner Leung?
Here.
Commissioner O'Leary?
Here.
Vice Chair Cordes is absent. Chair Horton is absent.
Next item is Pledge of Allegiance, and please rise. Commissioner O'Leary will lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
You can all place your right hand over your heart. Ready, begin.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Next item is public comments. Anyone like to speak about anything not listed on the agenda? Please come on up.
We close public comments.
Second.
Okay, public comments closed. Let's go right to the real business of tonight, which is the Historic Resources Survey presentation discussion. Director Mazura.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor and Council and Planning Commission. Welcome, everybody, tonight. My name is Steve Masura, the Community Development Director, and our department was the department that coordinated this process for this Historic Resources Survey. But a couple quick housekeeping items to let people know that after I introduce everybody, and we're going to get a presentation, and there's going to be a time for comments and questions. But if you'd please fill out the yellow speaker form if you do want to speak in the back on the table, that would be very helpful since this is considered a council and planning commission meeting. We need those. And also, since on the agenda we don't have an announcement section, I just want to make sure it's covered, that everybody's aware that there's a flyer in the back for there's going to be another joint meeting of the City Council Planning Commission and Public Safety Commission about our downtown parking study and strategic plan on August 14th at 7 o'clock in the same location. So I just want to make sure that was covered so we don't forget about it at the end. But certainly you can call staff at City Hall if you have any questions about that particular study as well. And that's going to be similar to tonight, by the way, more of a study session. There's not any specific actions that are going to take place, though they're going to come back to whatever respective commissions or city councils for final approval on things. So tonight is to hear about what's happening and get some discussion and dialogue and feedback from the commission and the council and the public on what's happening with our studies. And tonight, which is our Historic Resources Survey. This survey has been a kind of a long time coming for the city, not only because this is the first time that we're doing a historic resource survey for the city. The city's been, you know, since the town of Temple was started back in 1923, it's been many, many years. So there's a very unique and defined history here that you're gonna hear more about in the presentation. But also a long time coming, and that this has been a year-long process for the city to get a grant to actually fund some of this study a little over a year ago, and then hire a consultant, and then almost a year-long process for them to complete this survey. And hopefully all of you are aware that the survey is online on the city's website, and there's some copies floating around as well, and you can download it from the city's website. So with that said, I don't want to take too much time, but I want to introduce Paul Dybel as our Community Development Project Manager. He works part-time for the city, and he was a key person in keeping this project moving forward. And so he's here tonight to help supplement any information of the consultants, but also to answer questions. I'll give the council, well, let me introduce the consultants first, that we have Carrie Fowler and Christy McAvoy, who are going to be giving the presentation. And as I said, they have, what, half an hour presentation at least? Half hour plus to an hour, depending how it goes. The intention was to take comments at the end from the commission, council, and the public. I don't know if you want to take any interim questions, burning questions as we go.
Let's wait till the presentation.
Okay. The only other thing, Mr. Mayor, if there was anything you wanted to add about how this came about, I know that the council and the historical society had a great interest, and the planning commission, the previous planning commissioners had an interest in getting this study, to this, to fruition here. I don't know if you want to make any comments about that.
Well, we haven't. This is. We all know that Temple is a great city, but we really never had a historic survey done. I think after our 50th anniversary, I think the interest in the history of Temple City really peaked, in not only in the city council, but among all of us. So it was just the right time. And we've seen a lot of developments, a lot of the more notable buildings disappearing from the city. So we really feel that now's the time, not only looking back to the past, but planning for the future. And the best way is to take note of what we have and try to preserve all the good things that we have from the past. So,
thank you. So, without further ado, I would introduce Carrie, I think, to start.
Can everybody hear me?
Good.
I am Carrie Fowler. I'm a senior preservation planner with Historic Resources Group. We are a historic preservation consulting firm located in Pasadena. And as Steve mentioned, the city invited us about a year ago to conduct a survey of potentially historic buildings throughout the city. So the first part of this presentation, I'm going to go over kind of a summary of the results of the survey. And then in the second portion of the presentation, Christy McAvoy will talk a little bit about what the survey means, what some of the next steps might be, and things to think about if and how the city chooses to go forward.
Excuse me, Carrie.
Yes.
Just the screen is kind of hard to read, but there is handouts of the presentation in the back if anyone didn't get it.
So we do have a lot to get through, so I'll try to go a little bit quickly so we do have time for a question and comment at the end. So just a little bit of background. As you may or may not know, the city currently does not have any historic preservation mechanisms in place. So the survey is really kind of a first step that we were asked to do for the city. A portion of the survey was funded by a grant from the National Trust of Historic Preservation that the city received. The city commissioned us to do a citywide survey. So the survey area that we concerned ourselves with were basically defined by the city boundaries. And the purpose of this was to identify potential historic buildings, to evaluate those buildings both for potential local designation as well as state or national designation if that applied, to consider resources and how they might relate to the local planning process, and also to think about a possible future designation for any of these resources. So again, we were looking at the entire city. So you may have seen myself or some colleagues driving up and down every street and looking at every single property. So this is a very comprehensive look at the city. Part of what we do is develop a historic context statement, which is a narrative history of Temple City, not the history of everything that happened in Temple City, but the history of the built environment. We're not going to go over that in specifically today, but again, if you do get a copy of the report, there's a 30-plus page narrative history of the city, which I hope you all will read. And the way that's organized is we're basically looking at broad themes and patterns of development in the city and trying to tie those to the existing buildings that we see on the street today. So that's kind of the purpose of that narrative. And then what we do with all of that information is we go out into the field and we do a property by property field survey. So in the case of Temple City, we were focusing on properties constructed prior to 1970. Usually we kind of have a 50-year rule where we look at properties constructed over 50 years ago. Because you're a fairly new city from 1963, we wanted to take that number a little bit further into the recent past, so we used a 1970 cutoff there. One of the bases for our survey was a very detailed list of older properties that the Historical Society has compiled, and that was provided to us by the city. So we did use that to help us identify some of the older structures in the city. All of the survey work was done from the public right-of-way. That's standard practice, so we're not going on to private property. We're staying on the street and on the sidewalk. And generally, we're looking at the primary building on the parcel. So we're looking at basically the house or the store that's on the front of the parcel. We're not looking behind to see if there's anything behind. So the types of resources we're looking at individual properties. We were looking for potential historic districts, and potential conservation areas. And I'll talk a little bit in a minute about what those things are. In terms of eligibility, as I mentioned, we were looking for things that might be eligible at the local level, meaning as a landmark or a point of interest, and I'll talk about that in a moment. Things that might be eligible for the California Register of Historical Resources, which is the statewide registry, and things that might be eligible on the national level for the National Register of Historic Places. So very typical for a survey project that you want to look at properties at all three levels. And the last point there, designation criteria. Because the city currently doesn't have their own criteria for evaluating historic properties, we use the criteria that the California Register uses, which are very standard. They're very similar to the criteria of the National Register. And we just applied those at the local level. So what did we provide for the city? Up to this point, in addition to the survey report, we have provided a property data table, which is basically a very large Excel spreadsheet, if you're familiar with digital spreadsheets, that contain all of the information that we gathered about all of the properties that we looked at. So that includes basic pieces of information like the address and when the property was built, in addition to kind of evaluation information that we determined what style is the building, what kind of integrity does it have, what kind of historic associations do we know about the building. So all of that information has been compiled in one digital format. The purpose of that is that we provide that to the city, and then the city, I know, is working on a GIS database that will be ultimately available through the website. So once that information is linked to that database, then individuals can go onto the website, click on a parcel of their property or another property they're interested in, and that will bring up all of the information that the survey gathered so that you have access to all of that information. We did also photograph all the properties digitally. That's a very important component of a survey. You want to have a record of what the property looked like when we were actually out there surveying it, because as you know, things can change. So I'll go quickly over the results. We identified 96 properties that we thought were potential landmarks. We'll go over these in more detail in a moment. 4 points of interest. We did not identify a historic district, but we did identify a conservation area, and I'll explain what the distinction is there. So to go over a little bit about the landmarks, I would say about two-thirds of the landmark properties we identified are residential. This includes 15 residents that predate the town of Temple, so that actually are pre-1923. There are a variety of architectural styles, and I'm sure you're familiar with the styles that you have here, Craftsman, Spanish Colonial Revival, and Tudor Revival, among the most common in your historic properties. And often what we were looking for was were good examples of early residential development in Temple City. In terms of commercial properties, we identified 17 commercial buildings and signs. Couple of different ways to look at these. Are they a good example of early commercial architecture? Are they a good example of auto-related commercial development? Are they a good example of a style? And in some cases, you had good examples of mid-century neon signage that we identified. institutional buildings, we identified about 15 of those. They included schools, churches, civic buildings, municipal infrastructure. These included things like early examples of institutional development, similar to the commercial, good examples of the style, maybe the first church, the first school in town, those kinds of things. And just a few more photographs there of some of the properties that we identified. And again, this is an overview, but all of these things are spelled out in the report in a bit more detail. So because we were using the California Register criteria, all of the properties that we identified to be locally eligible, we also identified as being eligible for the California Register. So those 76 properties. Of those, seven of them we thought would be eligible for the National Register. The points of interest, a little bit different than a landmark. A point of interest is a property that is historically significant. It has a lot of importance to the community, but it has a lot of alterations. So sometimes it's difficult to, when you're looking at the building on the street, to see how the property is historic or understand how that property relates to its historic period. The four corner buildings at Temple City and Las Tunas, as you probably know, are four of the most important buildings in Temple City. Unfortunately, they've all been quite altered. Stucco, cladding, alterations of windows and window openings, that kind of thing. But you're very fortunate that they're still there. And so we didn't want to ignore those buildings because we understand their significance. So what we identified them as, rather than landmarks, is a point of interest, which is a designation that you could have where you can acknowledge the significance of the property, but without kind of freezing the historic, or without freezing the materials in place. And in fact, you might want to encourage some restoration of those properties to make them regain their appearance from their historic period. So we identified those four properties as points of interest. Historic district, as I mentioned, we did not identify a historic district. That is something we usually look for, and we didn't for a couple of reasons. One is when we kind of looked at the most historic area of Temple City, there seemed to be kind of an incremental pattern of development, so as opposed to other places where maybe the whole place is built in the 20s. You had some development in the 20s, some in the 30s, some in the 50s, some in the 70s, and so you can really see that on the street, but as a result, you don't get a very cohesive concentration of historic buildings. Also, there has been quite a bit of demolition of some of those earlier buildings or alterations of some of those earlier buildings. So in terms of trying to find a high concentration of very intact historic buildings, we didn't find that. But what we did identify instead is a conservation area. And the boundaries of the conservation we identified are essentially the boundaries of the original Temple town site that was subdivided by Walter Temple in 1923. That's the area bounded by Encinitas Avenue, Garibaldi Avenue, Baldwin Avenue, and Live Oak Avenue. And this would include the residential area as well as the commercial area. And even though there's been alterations to the historic fabric, the character of the area is still very apparent. When you drive up and down the streets, you can really tell when you're within that historic town site. The street patterns, the street trees, the light fixtures, the overall scale of the development is very apparent. So a conservation area would be a way to acknowledge all of those kind of planning and landscape features that a particular area has and protect those things. So in a little bit more detail here, things like uniform lot sizes, the concrete sidewalks and street trees, primarily one-story single family with landscape parkways and streetlights. In the commercial area, primarily one-story front, storefront set right at the sidewalk. Pedestrian orientation, the signage, those are all characteristics of the conservation area that you might want to preserve. So this here, it's a little bit hard to see, but this is kind of a summary map of the city with all of the properties identified there. This map is also in the report, and also there's a list in the report so that you can find specific addresses and that kind of thing. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Christy McAvoy, who's going to talk a little bit about what does all this mean and what kind of next steps you might want to consider. I'm going to leave that moment up there.
I have to bring this down a little. Good evening. My name is Christy McAvoy. I'm a founding principal of Historic Resources Group. We're currently located in Pasadena. Carrie gave you a rapid overview of the history of the built environment of Temple City. I'm sure that all of you have your stories and know a lot about the built environment. Some of you, can I ask you if there are any natives in the audience? Were you, anybody born here? Wonderful. Okay. So you've seen it change maybe a little bit over your lifetime, but there are some characteristic building features and landscapes that have come to be very familiar to you. And so when we're using the terms built environment and historic resources, what we're trying to do is wrap a story around those places that you see every day and perhaps try to get you to look at them in a slightly different light. And also to understand how this physical fabric impacts your community and how you want to make it grow to meet your needs for today. So the survey is actually a way of putting the buildings that you see every day in context and looking to see what stories they tell. And as Carrie said, we did a multi-page study looking at the themes of Temple City, the themes of residential development and commercial development, what architectural styles are present here in the community, just things to kind of help all of us organize our minds around the kind of buildings that are important to the community. We did not attempt and would never attempt a comprehensive history of Temple City because there are experts here in this community who know far more than we do about the individual people and places that built Temple City, people in particular. So we know that the Historical Society and others has documented that well over the years. What we're looking to do here is to add a picture of the built environment of the places that went with the people that Temple City, and to show you what Temple City has become. So with that, I'm going to try to talk about, Carrie told you, the amount of effort that a survey takes to do, the fact that we got some grant funding from the National Trust for Historic Preservation. The National Trust encourages communities like yours to look and see what their built environment is in the hope that there is going to be some planning process that will keep significant buildings in the community. It's the first step, usually, in a comprehensive local planning process that takes these buildings into account. You use it as a strategic tool. Properties identified in a survey are useful to planners and the city council when they are deciding what kind of impact a new development might have on your community. And many of you may be familiar with the term CEQA, the California Environmental Quality Act. That's what the planning department and local officials use to assess impacts for new projects and to see whether or not they may impact something of historic value. You use the survey as a basis for consideration for future methods to preserve historic resources. It's the baseline where we start. It's by no means the end. We put this slide about benefits of historic preservation in for your consideration tonight because communities that have historic surveys, historic planning tools like ordinances or specific plans or things in their general plan that talk about the historic built environment often find that preservation creates jobs because it's a little more labor intensive than new construction. And actually, the National Trust has some statistics to prove this. That it can attract and retain small businesses, that it provides access to some financial incentives for those owners who own historic properties, that districts and conservation areas can stabilize or increase property values, a couple of the cities to the north of you have actually done a few studies like this. Pasadena has done one. And we know that property values are slightly increased in designated historic districts over undesignated, same character neighborhoods. Historic public buildings can save public dollars in their reuse. They're eminently sustainable because they're already built. That is one of the biggest forms of sustainability today. And things that when public dollars are tight, you want to be careful about that. Resources attract visitors to a community because if you can tell your story to people who are coming, your story in Temple City is not like the story of Pasadena, is not like the story of Alhambra, is not like the story of Los Angeles. So you want to get out there and tell your version of Southern California's history. We all share things in common, but each city tends to be unique. And rehabilitating buildings, as I said, is kind of a good way to care about the environment as opposed to new construction. So we're here, we have identified potential, a group of just over 100 buildings that meet the criteria that the state and national preservation organizations have set out that tell you about the significance of a building. I'll kind of pause here to say that every old building does not meet the criteria to be a historic building. And I'd kind of just like you to keep that in mind as we go through, and we'll have some questions about that. So we start with age, but then there need to be themes and contexts and enough architectural integrity to convey the building's story. That's what kind of usually leapfrogs you from an older building to something with historic significance. So the next step in this process for you, now that you have an inventory or a survey report and an inventory of potential historic resources, is to possibly adopt that inventory, that list, and publicize it so that people understand in the community what we have here. Another potential next step is to adopt a local ordinance to protect those buildings and their character, to encourage the use by property owners of financial incentives that may become available to property owners of historic buildings, designated historic buildings, and also to develop and add to some of the design guidelines that you already have in place. Temple City has design guidelines for both single family structures and commercial structures. There's not a portion of those guidelines that fits historic resources right now, so it's something that we're going to talk to you about adding. We're going to spend the next few minutes talking about those next steps in a little more detail. When you have further time, there's some future actions you can also take a look at that will integrate historic preservation into your policies, one of which is to incorporate goals into the general plan. Another one might be to, again, as reviewing the existing design review process and supplementing it, developing this database that Carrie talked about so that everyone can look at a geographic information system and have a picture of that property. It's a great planning tool to be able to integrate a historic survey into your GIS, your potential GIS system. And then should you decide to take all of the rest of these steps, the state of California and the National Park Service offer you a designation called a certified local government designation, which allows you some grant money and some things to take care of your resources should you choose to adopt an ordinance and do things in the way that that has some state approvals. So again, the next step is an inventory. Should we adopt the portion of the survey, officially adopt it? City Council may want to officially adopt the survey from the City Council standpoint. Adoption makes the survey the first official inventory you have. It covered a lot of ground, so it is a representative sampling of excellent architectural styles and all the different kinds of buildings that make up this community. The city then would develop a program to update the survey. Everyone recommends that, preservation practice says that you update a survey every 5 to 10 years, both because buildings get older and reach that kind of threshold of 50-year marks, but also because more becomes known about the buildings in the city. And adoption includes a public process. So we're looking then at one of the first next steps that we're going to ask the community to consider at this point, which is the adoption of a local preservation ordinance. It's the primary tool that will protect your historic resources. Ordinances are always tailored to the particular needs and resources of a community. So we have not and would not urge you to adopt an ordinance, for instance, written for the city of Pasadena. Every community is different. Every ordinance, however, has certain provisions that I'm going to go through that they have in common. But an ordinance at the local community level needs to address the particular needs of the community. The city's existing general plan and code need to be reviewed and actually need to be reviewed for consistency in terms of policies and objectives that you already have. And again, this part of it is a public process. An ordinance also can include the encouragement of the use of financial incentives. There are government incentives for owners of historic properties. We've listed four of them here. If you own a property which is income producing and meets the criteria for National Register designation, there are federal historic preservation tax credits that you can use. The city has federal money in the form of community development block grant funds that it could choose to allocate a portion of for historic preservation. The state has a property tax abatement incentive whereby owners of historic properties get a portion of their taxes abated if they agree to rehabilitate their properties according to certain guidelines. And there are occasionally, not now, some state bond programs. So again, we have to look at what incentives might do, might be good for this community. Occasionally, a property owner will decide that they want to preserve a property in perpetuity because it is so special to them. That incentive is called a preservation easement. Often cities want to adopt fees or parking waivers for historic buildings to encourage owners to keep them in use. And again, in the enhanced property values of recognized historic buildings are incentives in themselves. So what would an ordinance do for you? There are about nine components of an ordinance. An ordinance is a law that's put in the municipal code. Almost all historic preservation ordinances in California are based on a model ordinance by the State Historic Preservation Office, and they include a purpose and enabling ordinances and whether or not there's going to be a preservation commission, the procedures for action, how you appeal it, and enforcement. It's pretty much like any other ordinance. The purpose statement just says in a very clear and succinct way that we value properties of historic significance in Temple City and indicates that the city wishes to preserve that and would then state that the community wishes to accomplish that by putting this into an ordinance. I realize that this right now is a little hard to see, and I know that a lot of you are following along on the PowerPoint presentations, which also is probably a little hard to see because it's not printed pretty very large. And should you have a question about any one of these provisions as I walk through them, I know it's going to be in the next few minutes I'm going to cover a lot of ground, so if you have a question, just note it on the slide that you have in your PowerPoint, and we'll get back to having you answer the question or answering the questions for you. Second part of an ordinance says very carefully who is the legal authority that is able to regulate historic resources. In most cities, that's the council and their designees, the staff people, a commission, and so on. The meat of a historic preservation, one of the provisions of the meat of a historic preservation ordinance is whether or not you establish a preservation commission and whether or not that commission speaks directly to the city council, whether or not that commission is advisory to the city council, what kind of powers that commission might have in terms of what activities fall under that jurisdiction, again, whether it's advisory or mandatory, and how it relates to the city council and the planning commission. That commission is usually charged with some local preservation education programs, holding meetings or educational seminars or educational programs about the kinds of buildings in the community. So it's a help for the city to let the citizens know about what kind of historic resources you might have. Every ordinance has to have procedures and criteria. What kind of buildings will qualify? It needs to be consistent with the criteria for identifying historic buildings promulgated by the California Register of Historic Places. That's what our planning in California is based on, the California Environmental Quality Act. So it is helpful to have a local ordinance that reflects those goals and that environmental quality of planning. The ordinance should provide the designation for individual properties, possibly calling them landmarks. Some cities call them monuments. Some call them places of significance. We choose to put landmark on this slide because it's a very concise term. That's not the only one that allows you to identify historic resources. As Carrie pointed out, there are sometimes historic resources that have a place in the community, but they don't meet the criteria in terms of architecturally being architecturally significant or having enough integrity to tell their story. She gave the example of the Four Corners buildings, which have been altered over time, but it's such an important story that it somehow needs to be acknowledged. So we normally group those in things called points of interest. The ordinance would provide a geographically definable group of properties as a historic district or a conservation zone. We did not find properties in enough of a significant concentration to qualify for most definitions of historic districts. So we're encouraging the term conservation zone or conservation area so that you can protect the character of the original Temple City town site. Ordinances are not to use age as the sole factor. They always have to have additional criteria, and they recognize the potential for regulating non-historic resources sometimes if they're within historic settings. More procedure, differentiate between alteration and demolition. What kind of actions do you want to have an ordinance take? It should clearly define and regulate whether it's interiors or exteriors. You can choose which way to go. Some cities regulate both. A lot of cities only regulate exteriors, things that can be seen from the street. The ordinance language identifies what a minor alteration is and how someone with a minor alteration doesn't have to go through an entire process to talk about an alteration to a home. And it would differentiate, if you have a historic district, you would differentiate between contributors and non-contributors. There's also in the ordinance the consideration of economic effect on the property owner, both from a rehabilitation standpoint and from what the city is trying to achieve in terms of keeping up the quality of its historic landmarks. So most ordinances these days talk about Mills Act property relief. They talk about maybe reducing parking. They try to find a very fairly broad range of allowable uses so that if a building was built for a certain purpose, say it was a church, but it's not going to be used as a church any longer, can we do some adoption that would still allow the character-defining features of that to remain? Potentially, you might want to look at reductions in fees because we're going to have some permits attached to this. Expedited processing with checklists that are that reflect the architectural character and what you want to do with historic resources. You actually have a checklist in your design review. Some modification of that checklist for design review could be very useful in helping owners understand what are character-defining features of properties. And then you need a procedure for extreme hardship if someone wants to demolish a property. How do you look at that? What kind of regulations do you put in place? Do we need a certain amount of economic return to a property? What does a property owner need to look at? And how is the property economically viable or not? Is the existing use of the property what we could make of it or not? So all of that are in the ordinance the consideration of economic effects. Every good ordinance needs an appeal process. You are all undoubtedly familiar with appeals and how if a body like the Planning Commission makes, it's the easiest one, example to use, makes a determination or a staff makes a determination that is appealable to the City Council. It's the way local governments run. There needs to be, for the staff and for decision makers as well, some fairly clear enforcement provisions. What are the remedies for non-compliance? How do we have an enforceable ordinance that talks about maintenance requirements for historic buildings? Historic buildings are no different than other regular community buildings in your community, and you probably already have building and safety maintenance requirements built in to certain parts of your ordinance. So the question is, do we need to supplement that for historic buildings or not? And enforcement provisions need to be strong enough to deter violations. So one of the most important sections, actually, of an ordinance of this type are the definitions. Ordinary definitions that everybody can read that include kind of carefully conceived sets of definitions and terms. We all know what a single family residence is. We might not all know about what a Tudor Revival single family residence is, although I suspect many of us do. We might not know exactly what's meant by minor and major alteration to a property, or what it covers from exterior to interior. Definitions have to clearly establish the scope of the regulation under the ordinance. And we are fortunate here in California and in the United States that several bodies from the National Park Service on down have actually really written a series of very carefully worded definitions for you to look at in your consideration of an ordinance. The other tool we can use, and a tool that you already use in your city, is design guidelines. But now we're talking about design guidelines that are solely for the purpose of keeping historic properties looking like historic properties. So they maintain and enhance the character of the existing historic built environment. These guidelines, in addition to the ordinance, are tools that are going to provide the roadmap for maintenance and rehabilitation. They should provide clear guidance for compatible new construction, something that you actually already have in this city, but has not been looked at, filtered through the lens of the historic built environment. Guidelines for historic resources, on the other hand, are often based on something called the Secretary of the Interior Standards for Rehabilitation. They are a series of guidelines put out by the National Park Service that tells how to treat historic fabric from windows and doors and porches and wood and brick and stone. They're a catalog of the appropriate methods whereby you can keep historic and older materials viable so that they will last longer. And this is a sustainability factor as well today in terms of, you know, how we use and conserve materials. Alterations need to be appropriate to the building style and the character-defining features. There is a term that a magazine coined a number of years ago called remodeling. You may be familiar with that. That was an Old House Journal construct. The construct being, can I import Victorian features onto my mid-century modern building, and what do I come up with? Well, I come up with a fairly kind of schizophrenic looking. The more styles I add, the more kind of schizophrenic it gets. And I can't clearly read the history of that building because there's so many layers on top of it. So in order to avoid that remodel or a person not being able to see clearly what the history is, we try to have alterations that are appropriate based on stylistic characteristics. We also want to have new construction and additions that can be compatible with the original construction. So Temple City has a design review process. It's a citywide design review, and I'm not going to be the expert on design review. We have a staff here to do that if you have questions about Temple City's design review. It applies to new and remodeled construction. It's advisory rather than mandatory. The downtown specific plan is a, you know, specific plan with a geographic area that talks about what we're going to do with commercial structures here. And but that downtown plan and the other Temple City design guidelines don't specifically address historic resources. So it's something that you might want to amplify with that. The survey identifies several common architectural types in the community. And so in the survey report, which you cannot read on this screen, are several pages of the most prevalent architectural styles in Temple City. And if you could read that, what you would find is that the paragraph in the beginning, at the beginning of the page, identifies the character-defining features of each style and what kind of characteristics it has. The bullet points in the middle of the page break down those character-defining features into a list of things that if you look at that style of building, you can actually see. And then we have some pictures, some examples of what those styles are. So here are just examples of what is in the report for architectural and character-defining features. Other cities have sample design guidelines, which again are picture models. I don't want to say that they're paint by number, but they often have drawings of the particular feature that they're talking about, or they have pictures of the particular feature that they're talking about on one side, and then they have some text about how the recommended treatment of those particular elements in a building. They also sometimes have the non-recommended treatment. So this is a sample that we just put up here so that you could see how design guidelines are often organized around architectural style. There's another page of that. They talk about setting. They are both for commercial and residential properties in terms of style. Here on the back of your handout is our four websites where if you want to go home and absorb this information at a quieter pace, the National Park Service, the National Trust for Historic Preservation, the State Office, and the Los Angeles Conservancy all have websites that talk about the rehabilitation of older properties. So I want to thank you for your attention to this part of the presentation. We tried to go through this fairly quickly so that we'd have a lot of time for questions both from Council, Planning Commission, and the audience. You have in your hand a series, I hope, you've all picked up a series of handouts that were back here on the table for you. And one of them, some of you have received a letter from the city saying that you may own a property which meets the criteria to be historic. Tonight we are not discussing how to designate, we're discussing that they meet the criteria. And the council and the planning commission may go forward to look at an ordinance, which is an actual designation procedure. And then you have the handout itself. So if you don't have any questions, if we've thrown too much at you tonight, you can email those to the city.
Correct. You can email them to me, smasura@templecity.us.
Okay. So, again, you have a wonderful city. You have a number of very interesting built resources which tell you the history of the city in various contexts. The question is now, what are the next steps to take in terms of preserving those assets and recognizing those assets, both publicizing them for the city and doing anything that you can to preserve them. So that's the end of our presentation. I know that there will be, Mr. Mayor, questions.
Well, thank you so much for that presentation. We'll first entertain questions from the council and the commissioners, and then we'll open up for public comments. And like Director Mazzura was saying, if you want to make a comment or question, please fill out one of the yellow forms so we can have a record of you. And so do we have any questions from the council or the commission?
I have a question.
Yes.
Ms. Fowler, are you this thing. There we go. Thanks, Carl. You indicated that your study didn't reveal any historical districts in Temple City.
No.
Now, is that the end of that discussion then, or, I mean, we...
No, actually, it's not. We're using, in this study, we are using accepted criteria by the state of California and the Park Service. Should you wish to have more discussion about what a historic district in Temple City would be, we could do that. Our recommendation now is because, as Carrie said, the neighborhoods and the city is mixed in terms of eras of styles, and there is not a completely cohesive style or era without intrusions from another style or era.
Right.
We're recommending that you take the approach of a conservation area.
Does size a factor in that in determining?
No, actually, size is not a factor.
Okay.
Historic districts can be, they usually have to have some size.
Right.
Sometimes you can have a cluster as small as 6 or 7, but it has to be very geographically contained.
Uh-huh.
Most viable districts are a block or a campus or some sort, and have some sort of organizing mechanism within them.
Okay. Now, you identified several architectural styles.
Correct.
That's not the end list, so there are other styles in Temple City.
There are other styles. Yeah. Tonight's presentation, we picked the most prevalent architectural styles. In the data table that we have provided with you, there is an architectural style for each building that we've looked at.
And just one last question. I think you already answered it, but I just want to make sure the inventory of historic resources that you were talking about, that can be changed at a later date or added to.
Yes, it can.
And you recommend every.
There are mechanisms for many councils adopt an inventory from a survey that has been done and then add to it or subtract from it over time based on whether or not the resource still retains its integrity.
Great. Thank you very much.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Well, actually, I have several questions. First of all, I commend you for the great report that you have done. And
Thank
for
you.
Those of you who haven't read it, it's very nice reading. Actually, it gave a lot of history, actually, the architectural or built environment history about Temple City all the way, even before the city was formed. It's very, very good reading. And I have the fortune actually working with the Historic Resources Group. I'm working on the Hall of Justice from the county side. They are the county's historian, architecture historian. They are also involved in a lot of historic preservation throughout the LA area.
Thank you.
So thank you for that good report. Just for my knowledge, and I'm sure other people might be interested in this too, when you say that there are 96 properties eligible for listing in the California Register of Historic Resources, is that a long process to get that registered?
Were you to try to list those properties in the California Register, building by building, without having a local ordinance or anything like that, the actual process to be listed in the California Register takes 6 to 9 months.
Six
and the
nine.
Reason for that is that the body that makes the decision as to whether or not you're listed in the California Register only meets 4 times a year.
I see.
So there is an application process. It is not terribly onerous. So in the absence of a local ordinance, you could nominate them individually.
But with a local ordinance, would that speed up or help the process?
A local ordinance is, I'm now going to speak personally. It is usually better that people have this conversation face-to-face at the local level, and so that there can be, all sides can be heard about designation and the information about a property. Also, most of the time, enforcement is local. The California Register does not have enforcement mechanisms.
Okay.
No one's going to come visit Temple City in this era of straightened budgets to determine what should happen to those.
One of your first recommendations is to adopt the historic survey that you prepared. by adopting it, what does that mean to the individual owners whose property may be listed as one of 96 or the four? What does that really mean? Because obviously, and we got a letter actually from one of the homeowners saying that they were a little concerned what would happen to property value and what they can do with it. So just the listing or the adoption of
just the adoption.
What does that mean?
The adoption of an inventory is primarily a planning tool for decision makers and the staff to be able to, when someone comes to make an alteration to a property that may be significant to the community, they have a way to assess that. They know that, those properties on that inventory meet the criteria that they have to look at for the California Environmental Quality Act. That's not a designation. That says the adoption of the survey or the adoption of an inventory is not the individual designation of a property. It's a planning tool.
I'm having trouble hearing you. It's a what?
It's not the designation of an individual property. It's a planning tool for the group of properties which meet the criteria for these various listings.
Do we have any other questions from?
I have one more. One of the steps that you recommended was the establishment of the Historic Preservation Commission.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we do have an active historical society in town.
Mm-hmm.
Do you recommend a role for them, or how does that fit in?
Always. having worked in a number of communities across the state, I know that governments, and particularly governments in smaller cities, don't have a way of servicing a huge number of commissions. It is very helpful from a historic preservation standpoint to have a group of people, whether you call it a committee or a commission, and what kind of status you give it, that already has the knowledge about the community and about the properties in it. Some commissions in some cities establish a procedure whereby people are qualified to be appointed to that commission. You might have to be an architect or a historian. Others have more informal advisory committees in which members can be appointed from certain disciplines. So it's not mandatory to have one, but it is helpful to have the advice of a group of people who take the time to educate themselves about historic preservation.
Right, thank you.
Go ahead.
So if I could just follow up on that, I guess the distinction between historical society, which is usually a number of people that in the community just volunteer their time to help preserve that, versus a more formal commission, which you're saying that the people on that commission would bring some professional skill to the table to help.
They could do that, but members of the historical society could serve as members of a commission.
Just a clarifying question. You mentioned that it's if we adopt the survey, then it becomes a planning tool. So it doesn't designate any individual property as an historic building. But I can't recall exactly what you said, but I believe that I got the feeling that if a property owner had a property in that planning tool as the adoption, what responsibility does the property owner have at that point? Because we wouldn't have an ordinance in place,
no.
Correct?
And that's exactly correct.
Right. And I'm not sure if you said that the city would then look more closely at that property. I don't want to put words in your mouth, but
that inventory or survey adoption is indication of historic significance. Only an ordinance can designate. So you're looking at a planning tool for staff when they do design review, when they're looking at what the alteration is, you know, things of that nature for people who need permits. You already have a version of this in your design review now, but there are some better procedures that you could adopt based on historic architectural styles, et cetera, that would help the homeowner keep the character.
And that would be down the line, after an ordinance
yes,
was established.
That could be, or design guidelines, you're going to have to decide. We're recommending an ordinance and design guidelines, or an ordinance and amending some of your design guidelines. Both are tools, but they're both very different tools. An ordinance will designate, that means the property owner has some responsibility, but it also means the property owner gets some incentives. There aren't usually ways to get those incentives without an ordinance and a designated building.
Right. So I just wanted to make sure for the audience that if we did adopt the survey, that we wouldn't need to have an ordinance to change some of the guidelines. Is that what you're saying? Or we would have to have an ordinance to change some of the guidelines?
To amend your design review guidelines to have language regarding historic buildings, you would not have to have an ordinance.
You would not have to have an ordinance. So that can be done administratively.
I'm going to defer to staff for a minute because I don't want to talk about procedures in your city without doing that. But the two things are separate actions and separate activities, correct?
And I think that's the concern that some of the residents have asked me to ask tonight is, if we did adopt the resolution, what could that be done administratively where there was some amendments before there was actually an ordinance?
The design guidelines could be established and implemented in a variety of ways. Currently, there are some specific design guidelines in the code, but there's other design review processes that we do that aren't specifically in the code, where we try to get the best design we can, but it's more of a voluntary, not necessarily mandatory. And even some of the design guidelines in the code aren't necessarily mandatory. They're more recommended, but we try to use them to get the best developments when we do design review. So it would vary on how we establish it, how we implement it, and what level it would be considered mandatory or not.
I think also design guidelines for historic buildings are educational. People understand that buildings are kits of component parts, and certain components match and may enhance the value of the structure vis-a-vis having a structure damaged in integrity.
That's correct. We do try to use them as educational tools as much as we can to at least advise people that here's a better way to design something to make it more consistent with the either existing character or the historic character, or in general just to make a better design. One of the benefits of actually having written design guidelines, though, is that you're tailoring it more to the specifics of this city, number one. And number two, since they're written, they're more consistent in an application where you may have staff that aren't architects and experts in that area, but at least you have something that was established by some expert consultant or architect in the process that is much more usable than just relying on staff's knowledge, for example.
Thank you.
Go ahead.
Couple of things that I find this whole issue problematic for personal reasons. Isn't the intent of, be it an ordinance or amendments, to in fact maintain the designated properties as they are?
I would amend that slightly.
Or the identified, you know.
The intent of either one of these things is to maintain the character-defining features, the majority of the character-defining features of a property, whether that's an architectural style or the materials it was built with. But it is not intended to freeze the property in time. It's to say, we use the word rehabilitation as opposed to restoration for a reason. Rehabilitation is a process in which you keep the character-defining features of the building that you start with, but you are able to upgrade it for today's uses, upgrade today's mechanical systems, things that people want in their homes now that might not have been there in the 1920s. That's the purpose of design guidelines, not necessarily to completely freeze a property in time.
And we get to determine that, right? I mean, that's something that we would determine. We can decide to be as conservative or as liberal as we want. That's part of preparing the ordinance.
Yes, and also part of design guidelines, which is why we did not come here tonight with either one. We, you will soon, as the way I understand it from staff, receive it, what I am now calling an annotated draft, which gives you some choices of provisions that you could put into an ordinance. And the reason we showed you the examples of the design guidelines were that they're all kind of basically set up the same way, but you can decide which parts of that you might want to add.
I happen to own a property in another city, which will go unnamed, smack dab in the middle of a historical preservation district.
Okay.
If I want to replace a 2x4 in that structure, I have to use an actual 2x4. 2x4s nowadays aren't 2x4.
They're something else.
So I have to go out and find a real 2x4 and put it in there. I mean, it's that restrictive.
Okay.
There are multiple units. They're totally undersized. You know, and if it was up to us, we'd tear the whole thing down and make some nice water, but we can't. We're completely stuck there. And myself and the other owners in the area are completely frustrated by this. We can't upgrade. And see, that's the first thing that comes to my mind when we have these conversations. People like to come by, they'll come out of a upper middle class area, in fact, dress in period costumes, and walk down the streets and look at all these old houses and say, oh, how quaint. And then they go away, and then we're left to deal with the problems of that are in those properties. There, I'm done venting, but that's the kind of concern that I have.
And there are those ordinances, and there are those design guidelines, and there are those cities that are very conservative and strict about both materials, styles, and what goes on within a certain designated area. That's the reason we're saying to you, if you don't have those kinds of areas or if you don't want those kinds of restrictions, you are not obligated to have that kind of ordinance. It needs to work for you and your circumstances. Now, I'm not saying it doesn't come without restrictions, because restrictions are the things that help keep the character-defining features, help keep the integrity of a property. So without any of that, you will continue to lose the integrity of the properties that we have identified through attrition, through, you know, possible alteration or demolition.
Sounds like a very fine line.
Christy, could
It's
could
a very
I?
Fine line. It's been around. It's one that you have to take. It's a challenge for each city.
I was just going to
add as a comment.
Observation that most ordinances, most historic preservation ordinances, have processes and procedures whereby, even if a property is designated, and oftentimes that is voluntary on the part of the property owner for a designation in order to be able to take advantage of the incentives and so forth. But conditions change over time, economic viability of a property change over time, and most ordinances have a procedure whereby designation can be rescinded. There are usually provisions for economic hardship, and if a bona fide case can be made that it's not economically feasible or viable to maintain a building in its designated in the status of having a historic designation, there are usually ways to provide relief in most ordinances. And there again, it all comes back. These are issues that the council and the commission can consider in terms of a broad range of approaches. And there's a lot of fine tuning that could and would occur if you decide to pursue alternatives and looking at alternatives. Those kinds of concerns can be addressed, I would think, to your satisfaction, but that's something that you would discuss, have interaction with residents and your constituents, and it would be a participatory process to get to that point, presumably.
The most important parts of an ordinance in that regard are the appeals process, for one, the incentives process, for a second, and being clear about what the criteria are for designation.
Do we have any questions from the commission? The council have been dominating the questioning and...
Oh, I didn't even know they were down there. Are they down there?
Yes.
Everyone in their own good turn, Mr. Mayor. I'd like to thank Ms. McAvoy and Ms. Fowler for the work you've done in coordination with staff. I read with interest the Historic Resources Survey, and I think it's good to capture and define the physical qualities that make the Temple City environment unique and which attracted many of us to the Temple City atmosphere and lifestyle as it is. The built environment is key to that, and it certainly was for me when I decided to move to the city. Some folks, and I think this has been touched on, are concerned about onerous mandates that historic preservation, for all of its good intentions, might impose on residents. And so I wondered if you could take a couple moments to talk about maybe the means that are available for folks to conform with these preservation requirements, if not specific to Temple City, in your experience, what funds, or I know you mentioned some grants, community development block grants, for example, but if you'd like to touch on that, because folks are maybe thinking, I have an unfunded mandate looming, how do we address that?
Right. And now we're going to talk about those properties which are actually designated by ordinance. That is usually the method. Usually properties that are designated by ordinance are given the possibility of having incentives that are not available to someone whose property may have significance but does not go through the designation process. So the incentives are one of the main incentives available to you as part of looking at an ordinance would be the adoption or the facilitation of a Mills Act contract for an individual property owner who could thereby save a portion of their property taxes in exchange for agreeing to certain rehabilitation, I wouldn't say requirements, but certain rehabilitation methods when they are going to come to the city to make changes in their houses. The Mills Act the nice thing about the Mills Act is it can be used for both residential and commercial structures, that it is locally administered, and it's a contract that the property owner enters into. Technical assistance is another incentive whereby a property owner can approach the city, and here we're talking about staff and what to provide staff with in order to facilitate that education to keep a home in good repair. So there are both technical assistance incentives and financial incentives. The city can, and many smaller cities do this, can determine that they're going to designate a certain portion of their fees or CDBG money or some kind of very small grant requirement to help homeowners with small repairs. And so that the homeowner is sharing the cost with a small city grant program. Those are all structured in very different ways, and we can talk about, you know, where those fees come from. Building permit waivers are another thing that can happen to ease the burden on a historic property owner. On commercial owners, often the city will waive parking requirements for the rehabilitation of a building as opposed to the new construction of a building on that site. There are several things that a local government can do to incentivize preservation in a community.
And just a quick follow-on question. I noticed in this report that some of the structures that you looked at were churches. Mm-hmm. Typically, nonprofits don't pay taxes.
No.
So the property tax issue might not hold as much sway for them, but it might create a financial.
In the case of institutions, what the normal incentive is usually grant incentives from a foundation, from a state grant or bond. I mean, the grants these days are extraordinarily competitive. So listed buildings, buildings that are listed on the National Register, listed in the California Register, or locally designated, usually go to the top of the criteria pile when grant-making agencies are looking where to spend their dollars.
Thank you. Are there any other planning commissioners that comments?
Yes. The word survey, is that meant in its definition that we survey the residents, or is that something that's not that?
No, that in historic preservation, that is a term of art that applies to buildings, not residents. Buildings can change ownership. So here we're looking at the quality of the built environment.
I was going to comment that I think this is really a good time, as others have stated, to have this kind of a evaluation done, because this is a time when the city is really in a changing mode, and the identification of these kinds of buildings that they exist, because I've lived here a long time and I've never really thought about how many of the buildings that actually are old and fit into the various different times of building that you have shown in your the work that you've done. And with respect to, you know, putting together a detail like this with an ordinance, I could just see where that, I mean, that's would be something that would be down the road after, you know, really getting some feedback from a lot of different people. But I know a city to the north that has Victorian style houses, I know there are major changes being made to them, and so I've seen where, you know, it's not something that on these kinds of houses that are designated necessarily, they, you know, are stopped from making changes, again, based on how the rules, the ordinances, and so forth are written. So.
It's more a question of appropriate change, not of stopping change, but of making appropriate changes for today's lifestyle in the context of how the building was created.
I have a question about the methodology of this survey. Is this based on some state, California state process, national process, or is it based on the history of our specific city, Temple C, as a case-by-case kind of study?
It is both. The methodology that we used was developed by the National Park Service and refined by the State Office of Historic Preservation. The State Office of Historic Preservation on its website has a pamphlet or guidelines on how to conduct a survey and what to put in it and how to put that in. So those are the general guidelines, and it also has professional qualifications in it for the type of people who are going to conduct these surveys, which HRG's personnel meet those professional guidelines from the National Park Service. So that's the general parameters under which we work. But the survey and the context that was developed in your survey in the report is specific to Temple City. It takes into account the patterns that we know about the development of Southern California, not just Temple City, because you do share certain characteristics with other cities around you and patterns of development. But we make that context fit your built environment from the guidelines that have been established in our industry.
Okay, we have asked a lot of questions, and we'll probably still have more, but, you know, we have a lot of interest from the public, so want to open up a public hearing if the council and the commission still have questions afterwards, and we can entertain them then after the public hearing. So I'd like to call on Mr. Douglas Ward.
Hi.
Yeah, please come up so we can all hear you. And
we have a microphone.
We don't have a mic.
Is there a mic you can use?
Well, great. One of the people who's a benefit of a trust on the 5948 Camellia property, which is designated, the property.
Can you speak into the mic a little bit more, please?
Excuse me?
Speaking into the mic a little bit more.
Sure, sorry.
Thank you.
I am one of the people who was part of the trust that was set up for the sale of a property at 5948 Camellia. And it's a property between two multi-family, non-1930s properties. And this particular property is a duplex, and it's on a fairly large lot. And the interests of the trust are that the trust sells the property and divides it among the people that own, you know, that are part of the trust. Now, as soon as this letter hit the mail, all the offers dried up, and the people who would be in the market for a large piece of land in between two fairly built-up parts of the town evaporated. And I consider myself a liberal, and I consider myself green, you know, and I consider myself, you know, I think about these things all the time. But after feeling the sting of that, I also want to talk about what it is that the city lives on, and that's the assessed valuation of all these parcels that the city is part of. And if you have a parcel and you're trying to get rid of it, and you can't sell it because somebody laid a designation on something that's on that parcel, that creates a vacuum that lowers the tax base of the community. And I've seen this firsthand. It's the first time I've ever been hit by anything like this, you know. So it's a very complicated thing, you know. There's communities outside of this thing that in 30 years some preservation commission might come by and say, these are historical properties, you know. Or if they came by in the 1930s when this house was built that we own, they could have said, well, we don't want you to build there because this beautiful old farmhouse exists there, you know. And so, you know, one of my thoughts is that it's the nature of communities to grow, you know, and that that's what zoning is all about. In fact, I haven't heard anybody at this meeting talk about zoning, you know. I mean, if your property is zoned for multifamily occupancy, but it was built in 1930, does that mean that the property's dead, you know? I mean, there's a lot of unintended consequences to these kinds of community things, and they're really valuable to go through, and it's valuable to the community to think about this stuff. But you also have to see what the community is, and that is it's a viable organism that continually grows, and the tax base grows, and the you know, regulations and the people that enforce them are consequent to the people that that pay taxes, and the people that pay taxes are the people who are living you know, in these properties. And so if you freeze a community like this, or if the unintended consequences is to freeze a community like this, you'll get a place that, well, maybe might be more gentrified in the future, or maybe not. You know, maybe there's more beautiful communities. People that have their money would maybe like to go down by the seaside and get a historic property. You know, I mean, it's not like Temple City is this huge homogeneous community that's under threat by rapid developers. It's like it's always grown like this. You know, it's always, you know, the properties in one side probably was made in the 1950s, and the property on the other side made in the 1970s, and the 1930 house hangs in there, you know. But it's part of the upward spiral of the community, and now it isn't. It's off the market. I mean, it's, you know, it's can't be sold. I mean, if it can be, it's, you know, it's going to be at a discount. So I just like to tell you that when you start talking about these things, you have to think about all the consequences.
All right, thank you very much. Actually, Ms. McAvoy, you don't have to answer to any of this, right? Unless you can sit down and rest a little bit and then maybe give summarized a response. And in the interest of time, because we do have quite a few speaker here, please be conscious of time and please keep it to be 3 to 4 minutes. Next one, I'll call on Mr. Brian Brandes.
Well, my name is Brian Brandes. I live in Tampa City. I'm also a commissioner on the State Historic Resources Society.
All right.
Commission. So I, how are you? I'm going to speak on the other side. I applaud, I'll keep it real short, but I applaud both the city, absolutely, for putting this together, and I absolutely applaud the residents for coming here, because I think this is a great great group for the first meeting. I mean, this is the first meeting that I'm aware of. So this is a great turnout, and I would highly recommend any other future meetings you attend. This is the most important part, and there's going to be this controversy. So the most important part is to continue to participate and provide your input. And I'll just leave it that you can get a hold of me if you have any questions. What's that? Yes, we are having a meeting next week.
Next week.
Yeah, okay, yeah, absolutely. Good point. Thank you very much. Our meeting is local next week, and it's actually in Beverly Hills. It's not typically in Beverly Hills, and with the other state problems, don't read anything into that. We have four meetings a year, and they rotate around the state. Next week, it's the first and the second. It's a workshop on the first. The actual commission meeting is on the second, and you can actually see and hear our meetings and the properties that we designate. But again, I want to applaud you guys, both sides.
For anyone who might be interested, how can they find out a little bit more information?
It's posted on the state office website.
State?
It is posted on the state office website.
State Historic Preservation Office website.
Yeah. City Hall beginning at 9:30 on Friday.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Sorry. You'll be there?
I think that's hanging up.
Yeah. All right, thank you. Next, Franklin Riddle. Riddle?
My question is, could we develop a question and an answer as to why certain properties didn't make it? We've got everything that did make it, but I know where Jerry's cleaning establishment is, and I don't
no, his,
see.
His property's in it.
Well, his was,
winners?
You're right.
Yeah,
it's but
in
I'm
it.
Saying going west from there, I don't see anything in there. And yet I've been here since 44, and I know where there was a pool hall at one time. I know the properties on the south side of the street from where the theater used to be. I'm thinking of where Winchell's is or was. I'm also thinking of the Chamber of Commerce. These are properties that I'm saying, well, why didn't they make it? You can simply answer it by saying, well, they just didn't fit the years. Well, I would like to be a little more specific than that. So that us who, you know, across the street from where the Chamber of Commerce is, there's buildings there that used to have newspapers and other establishments in them. I would have thought they would have been in the same sequence, but maybe I'm all wet, maybe I'm all wrong, but I thought that type of a Q&A would help us who have been here a long time get a better handle on things. Yes, I happen to live in the county, what used to be county area, but it's now Temple City. And that I don't even think was considered in the outline, but maybe it was. I don't know. But I just thought that type of further information would be helpful for all of us. Thank you.
Right. Thank you. Mr. Watson Gang.
Well, thank you so much, Ms. Johnson and Ms. Fowler. Thank you so much for a great presentation. And thank you for your leadership here to propose such a noble thing. Well, my name is Watson Gunn. I'm a local realtor here in Temple City and the surrounding area. I happen to be a member among about a million or so strong in the nation who are not just putting sign in front of property, getting property. So our objective really is to defend property owner right and to be sure that property owner has the right to enjoy the freedom to do what they like to do with it. As you know, we as a society have been becoming increasingly concerned about Big Brother watching over us, whether it be from Washington, D.C. or Sacramento. And we have a wonderful council here and great city and not too much complaint so far. But I'm sure plenty of people would be concerned what would become of if a thing had not been done properly or perhaps the voice wasn't included. Well, case in point, I have been personally involved for the past 10 years or so in some property on our neighbor north of us, northwest of us in Pasadena, namely. There was a property that just had some river rock in front of it. The city made them go through three times as much as long to get the process approved and maybe twice as much for construction costs to add on whatever they had to add on. That was like before the market crash. We have this evening among our audience here, we have folks drove so from far, far away, I know. Welcome to be here. Good to see you back to Temple City. And I'm sure out of the 90-some property we have here, probably not everybody are here. Some are just people who bought property, who had to work at night. Perhaps some are elderly who are out of state. Perhaps their voice are not here. Now, the concern I have would be something maybe can be addressed to the council. Are we going to get more of an involvement among people who may not be here? I like what the councilman, Mr. Vizcarra, was saying about the 2x4. Even the 2x4, he had to go through a lot to imagine if like the doorknob, for example, needs to be replaced. Would you be requiring them to be the same identical one, which is 10 times as much, got to ship from New England or something? I don't know.
If you can find it.
If you can find it, yeah. So the point is, would we be able to, how are we as a city able to be sure that all the property owners are properly informed about the whole preservation thing and how would they be able to have a voice in it? And also, would we be able to allow them to have maybe have a survey or something come back? Can they opt out from their property if they feel like, based on their own plan, or perhaps their children or heirs' plan, are they able to opt out from whatever regulation that may be considered in the future? And how about maybe have some kind of a thing that we can reach out to them and get a response from them before some concrete decision were to be made in the future?
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Next call on Mr. Usama Nimri.
Good evening, everyone. I believe Councilman Vizcarra alluded to my question already, but I'd like to rephrase the question. There are advantages and disadvantages to any idea. Ms. McAvoy went through over many advantages for the owners. However, she did not go about over any disadvantages, but we did hear some disadvantages here from the public. One of them was the inability to sell a property. And I look at another disadvantage would be if it is a very popular place, then you'll have visitors all over, and that will not be advantageous to the owner. So I would like to, I would appreciate to hear some of those disadvantages that you encounter. And whether the owner will be, we know too many financial advantages to the owner if they're registered. However, it might cost them more to maintain it. So from your experience, can you tell us also or shed some light on that issue? Thank you very much.
Thank you. Ms. Wendy Payne.
Well,
We will. I thought we would do that collectively. Yeah, this being a public hearing. It's not exactly a dialogue.
Good evening. Thank you for the presentation. Thank you for sending out the letters so that we knew this was going on. I want to say to, I believe his name was Mr. Ward, who spoke first. Thank you very much, because you basically said what my concerns were. Mr. Vizcarra, also, thank you, because I think some of these points were well taken. So my question and my understanding is it so that since my house is on the list, and whether or not there's an ordinance, but just because now it's on the list, that at some future point, there may or may not be someone telling me that if I want vinyl windows for my house, because I can go to Home Depot and get those and be able to afford it, improve my house, but I can't because it's not going to go along with the style of my house. Is that what I'm hearing? That I'm not going to be able to do it, even though it may be economically feasible, may improve my house, but because it's not keeping in the characteristic of the original house that was built before, I can no longer do that? Is that correct? You get turned in a minute? Okay. You did speak about the incentives, but I know there are loopholes to a lot of those things, you know, like the Mills Act you spoke of. I think the owner has to agree for 10 years to be part of the Mills Act in order to get any incentives. So I think maybe I'd like to hear about the disadvantages too, to make this more fair. I feel like that just by receiving the letter, my property now has a cloud over it. Whether or not there's an ordinance enacted now, there was someone who said, even if we don't have it now, maybe at a future time. Or, you know, and now we're just full of maybes. We won't know. Maybe nothing will happen this year, but maybe next year someone will come in and say, okay, now we're going to have all these guidelines, and you're not going to be able to do anything with your house and add to it, and unless it's keeping in the character. And I liked what Mr. Ward said about communities evolve and change, and maybe some of these places need to change. So anyway, I'm concerned, and I like the idea of opting out if it's possible.
Right. Thank you. Mr. Howard, I think. Ducey? Sorry if I didn't get your name right.
Yeah, I'd like to thank the presenters. I've lived in Temple City for 30 years, and I've seen some changes going on. Some people have probably lived here much longer than I have, but I applaud the concept of preserving what we have within restrictions, if the restrictions aren't too restrictive. I mean, it sounds to me that, unless I'm wrong, maybe you could address this at a later time, but it sounds to me that an ordinance can be developed in a city that is specific to what that community wants. It doesn't have to be 2x4s that are 2x4s. It can be a much more broader approach. And I'm sure there's cities that are, I don't know about Monrovia exactly, but I know Monrovia has a little bit laxer a way of looking at these sorts of things from my understanding. But I think we need to preserve some of the structures that we have in Temple City to preserve the character of the city. As long as you don't go overboard in terms of, and the overboard comes with restrictions that in an ordinance that the council would recommend, and there has to be much more dialogue in terms of constructing those ordinances, you know, before they're, you know, this is it. In terms of the selling of the property, that's a factor. There's no doubt about that, whether it's saleable. If it can be redone, but what I was just thinking in my mind that when they talked about higher cost of restoring something back to normal, which is true, you go down to Home Depot with the lady just said, and you can buy a window for X amount of dollars, and it's maybe 3X times that when you have a professional restorer, you have to restore with the original material, but there could be something that a grant. A subsidy, something that would that the city council might okay, that would say okay, this is the price, the Home Depot price, and this is the price it costs to restore. We will make up the difference between those costs if you restore it back to the way it was. Now, I don't know if that's possible or not, but I mean it seems like there's something that's certainly feasible. But I applaud the idea of keeping certain structures And my house is one of those, is one of the 96. And I applaud the idea, this survey that was done, whether mine was picked or not, I would still applaud it. Because I think we have to keep a character of a city. If you don't have a character of a city, you know, pretty soon, it's, you know, whatever happens, there's no restrictions. I know we have, you know, there's building codes and requirements now, but you see changes, and some of the changes are not positive.
Thank you. Ms. Emily Williams.
Thank you. You asked earlier about Temple City natives, and I'm probably one of the very few. I was born at home in the house built by my great-grandfather. So I truly, I'm one of the few that Temple City is my place of birth. And so to say that I love it is wonderful. In fact, it's a home that past generations, my father is here with me, passed it on from generation to generation, but they realized they didn't really want to leave, and so we actually have a combined home, so I've been able to raise my son in the house built by his great-great-grandfather, which then leads to the question of, what do we do if we're not on the list? And our home is very close to Rosemead Boulevard, and we often have that concern of, does this type of designation, would it help us preserve a home that clearly means so much to our family, and has some local history, at least as far as our little group is concerned. So where do some of these ordinances maybe what can help us protect our homes here in Temple City as well? So that would be a question I'd love to have more information on, is either what can be reconsidered or if more information about the home were given, if that could be at all helpful. And so that is certainly a question we have. And then just again, thanking the city for that opportunity that I have had the opportunity to live anywhere in the world, and I choose to live in Temple City because that is truly our home, and what a wonderful family and wonderful history we have. So I appreciate any endeavor, even if it causes some discussion, that we have a community that cares so much about Temple City. So thank you for that.
Great, thank you. We've just gone through our speaker forms. Anyone else like to speak? Yeah.
Once again, to give away my age, there may be a few in the room who took the red car down Temple City Avenue. I mean, Las Tunas, excuse me. I took it down Huntington myself. I don't remember David taking it down Las Tunas. But I didn't quite understand where, is it P&E? Is that where the station was? I know it was Coughlin and Las Tunas, as I recall, but I didn't see any of that at all unless it was the P&E building that you designated.
Well, the P&E building doesn't
exist anymore. I understand that, but I'm saying, is that the place that it was?
Yes.
Okay, I didn't know if anybody else was confused like I was. I'm sure nobody else was, but anyway, I just thought that ought to be brought out. For those of us, as a child, my e-ride, for anybody that doesn't know what an e-ride is, you can ask me later, but my e-ride was taking the red car to Los Angeles to visit my parents with my grandmother. And all that was on Huntington, I think the same thing would be true on Las Tunas. And it should be duly noted somewhere, some way or another in doing what we're doing. Thank you.
All right, thank you. Anyone else? Please come on up. Well, it's being televised, so it's, yeah, please use the mic.
I'll break the camera then.
In regards to the PE building, I think it was moved. Perhaps I'm wrong, because I came here when I was 7 years old, and it's been a long time since I was 7 years old. I think it is now at 9173. Do you know, by chance, the gentleman who just spoke? Okay, I think it's 9.
I just remember, I think I remember a station.
Yes. 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 I do, too. There's a little bit difference in our ages, but yes, I remember it, too. Well, the thing is, I think it is now at 9173 Las Tunas. And I think the cross street is Encinita. But anyway, that would be a building to at least look at, because now it is a residence, or maybe more than one residence, I don't know. But anyway, my question is, for those of us who are really interested, may we please have a full listing of all the buildings that are under consideration? Because I don't think in the brochures that you gave out, the pamphlets and everything else, I don't think the
it's full... It's in a full report.
It is?
It is in a full report.
That was my... Yeah. That was why I was asking the question. What, why did you leave out this or that?
Yes. Well, the thing is, we would like to know exactly what is under consideration. But not only that, is it something that it is only the building, the structure itself, or is it something that also you would be interested in any structures or buildings or whatever, or residences where once upon a time important people or people of renown once lived? Because I can think of two buildings, in fact, they're both residences. One is a very nice structure, the other one is older and it may need a little work or whatever, but it is something that would be perhaps under consideration as well. And so that's what I wanted to ask.
All right.
Thank you.
Please fill out one of these yellow forms. Anyone else like to speak?
I'll move that we close public hearing.
All right.
Second.
All right. Thank you. Public hearing is closed. Now, some like the staff and or Ms. McAvoy to respond to some of the comments. But before we start, one of the questions was, will residents get a chance to speak on this issue before the ordinance will be enacted? Definitely. There'll be a separate public hearing for that. Depends on mechanism that we have chosen to do. Maybe we'll go through the Planning Commission first. Maybe the City Council will hear it directly, but there definitely will be a public hearing before any ordinance is finalized. Please go ahead, Ms. McAvoy.
And thank you to all the people who spoke who were so proactive about giving us just the information that we've gotten here tonight. I probably can't answer every question that was asked, but I'll do something to the best of my ability. There is a question asked by a couple of people about why certain properties didn't make it. So I didn't make it. So I'd like to kind of clarify what the guidelines are that we look at when we're doing a historic survey. These are not, by the way, the same kinds of things that you would look at when you were actually designating a building. You would have a fuller review of all of the historic significance of a building or property in your landmark application were you to start that process. A landmark application will give you a fuller information about the properties in question. First of all, the 100 plus or minus properties that have been identified meet certain historic criteria set up by the State Office for the California Register. One of the things that we didn't talk about tonight were alterations and what we call the integrity of a structure. There may be several places here in Temple City that are associated with events which cannot be seen from the street, or important people which cannot either be seen from the street but require more research. And we heard an example of that from one of the people who spoke. This is not intended to be a static list. This is intended to be the start of a conversation. And if people have information about properties that were left off that they feel should be on, then they should submit those and we can give reasons why they were or were not on the first list. But the main list, the main reason is, one, the building is not there any longer. And if the building is not there any longer, it is not included in the survey. This is not a survey about
structures that were there and are not there now. This is a survey about the physical structures that remain in Temple City that are historic. There were hundreds of buildings that no longer exist that we can see in books, in photographs, in people's memories, but they're not there now. So what we are looking at in a historic resources survey and talking about protecting are the survivors, the things that remain physically standing that we can actually read that story. It is unfortunate, but for those things that are gone, we have to rely on pictures and photographs. It is so much better to try to read the story in the physical building, and that's what we've attempted to do. So, and we do have a chronology, and there are certain things that we can add to that chronology in terms of certain events and certain things that had, you know, that were located. I mean, a lot of that information is in other histories. If the building is physically not standing, it may be in a local history, or, you know, and we want to add to that record. But this is a survey for physical buildings, so I hope that clears that up. The advantages and disadvantages. This is always a process that requires some conversation. And yes, I was emphasizing the advantages. There are disadvantages to this particular part of the process because there is not clarity here. There is often not clarity between current zoning and what the physical building is on that property, and that is something for future discussion. How do you wish to handle something that is not zoned for what the historic structure is on the property, and is there something that you want to do about that? I have owned historic property. I have sold historic property. I am certainly familiar with how it happens that you have a more selected group of buyers for a historic property. I also know that when there is a dislocation between zoning and a historic structure, that one needs to weigh the advantages and disadvantages of keeping that structure there. But the ability to sell in and of itself, there is no restriction on selling. And there are communities who do believe that historic properties in districts or individual properties are worth more than properties and have sold for more individually with a historic designation than without it. That is particularly true of people who enter into Mills Act contracts. There are probably a number of people here who have owned their property long enough to have pretty advantageous property tax situations under Prop 13. But the next owner of your property will not have that. If you have a Mills Act property on that property, it is an economic advantage to the buyer to buy an existing Mills Act property. It is true that the Mills Act is a 10-year contract, that it revolves for 10 years. You can enter into the contract and then, under certain circumstances, opt out of it. Sometimes if you give the notification and you don't want to stay in for the full 10 years, there is a penalty for that. But if it's a revolving contract, so if 1 year that you decide, if you've been in it for a while and you decide you don't want to be part of it anymore, you start that notification and you come out of the contract. It's a little hard to go into all the nuances of these incentives tonight, but I thank people for thinking about them. The question about, and I think we had a couple versions of these questions about appropriate rehabilitation. Can I put vinyl windows in my house? Will it cost more to put another window in? I think some people have said, you know, that's where a small subsidy may come in. That's where design review appropriate to the local level may come in. In certain types of historic districts, I know that there's a prohibition against vinyl windows. We did not recommend a historic district here, so we did not recommend the type of restrictive district that Councilman Vizcarra is familiar with. But, and when is it an improvement? That is actually more than in the eye of the beholder. Historic homes that retain their character-defining features have shown, real estate analysis has shown, that if you retain your character-defining features, your property, your return is higher. Your investment might be higher also, but your return can be higher when you sell the property. So the vinyl window question is something that comes up and is taken care of in design guidelines with all kinds of economic factors. This is not necessarily a gentrification issue. Just in something that we have to do a little more due diligence should you decide to pursue this conversation.
I think Mayor Pro Tem has a question on that.
I just want to share that I own two 1928 homes in the city of Whittier. And the city of Whittier is a place where historical preservation with homes has been extremely successful.
Yes.
And the homes that I own and rent are in the historic area, which you speak of. They are not in the historic district, which happens to be two blocks north of my property. And in the city of Whittier, I'm learning a little bit more. I've had the property a couple of years. It seems from talking to neighbors that the historic district is the area where overwhelmingly the people who lived in the historic homes were owner-occupied. Mm-hmm. And it's very expensive to get into the historical district.
Into the district. To buy into the district.
To buy into the historical district. And the property values are extremely high. These people cumulatively wanted to live in historic homes, or they've been passed down from generation to generation. I would have liked to have bought my property in the historic district. It wasn't as affordable as the historic area. If I choose to paint my homes, it's suggested that I paint them in the period, you know, that they were, you know, built. There's a lot of history with the two homes that I have. They actually happen to be the owner has a huge 10,000 square foot home that abuts my property, and these were the homes were the ranch head stayed. Mm-hmm. And there's a lot of history there. But these homes around my area are not owner-occupied. They are rental properties. And there's a whole different idea from if you buy into an area where you want to rent the property, obviously you're there to, you know, eventually, you know, make some money on the property. Much different than the historical district. Like you mentioned, in the historical district, the homes are very similar. They're pre-1920s. The character is very similar. Two blocks south, it's more like Temple City, where mm-hmm. there's one here, one there. So I could see the benefit of designating it similar to my, you know, property, which is an historical area where you get the buy-in from the property owners. They offer incentives to redo them. But I do have to say that there's a different motivation from people who live in Temple City and want to maintain the character and the properties versus non-owner occupied persons who, you know, are looking for the monetary gain. And I think what's difficult is for us to come to some balance with that. So I just wanted to share that because personally, you know, I'm experiencing something different than Mr. Vizcarra is, but I think it's good to know that people come to the table with different motivations for it.
They definitely come with different motivations and different sets of circumstances. And people who have rental property, who don't live in them, have difference or are a different class of owner than a person who has a single family house that they want to live in, that they are comfortable or even want to live in a designated and desire to live in a designated historic district, which is why the flexibility of some of these restrictions as we come with these, as we start talking about an ordinance or design guidelines or whether or not it's mandatory or voluntary, this is the start of that conversation. And we do need to be mindful of people's circumstances. One of the reasons the economic hardship provisions I showed in the context of what you would do when you put it in an ordinance, but there isn't a reason why you shouldn't look at some sort of test, some sort of other kind of economic test, as you're looking at design guidelines and how you want to do that. And yeah, our term for area, as you're expressing it, versus historic district has been conservation area for this presentation. You can again call it just about anything that you'd like to call it. Ordinances are more or less conservative based on a couple of things. One is the property owners who want to be in those areas and will consent to those. And the other one is, as we've talked about, that the current character of this city has completely evolved over time, giving us not the cohesion of neighborhoods from a historic sense that we might have in neighboring cities or in other circumstances. But out of the 10,000? Out of the 10,000 properties we surveyed, to look for characteristics associated with historic importance, we found just a little over 100. The sometime rule of thumb when we started surveys several decades ago now was that any city would probably find, due to growth, attrition, demolition, whatever, less than 10% of its built environment would meet the criteria for historic listing. So we're not talking about large populations here. We're talking about the character from certain types. To the Temple City native whose house was not on the list, again, more information about it that would allow us to answer that specific question, we'd be happy, certainly happy to look at. And given an answer. I suspect it might be something about alteration or integrity, but we can definitely look at that. We can acknowledge the route of the red car in the context statement, if that's something that's appropriate, and I think it was already kind of alluded to. We can check out the MOVE building that might be the PE depot, and any other, if you are not on the list and you thought you should have been, that's something that you should tell the staff about your property, and we or they should figure out a way that by the time an inventory gets to you, it may have those things. Now, the question about opting in or out of this process, the process is not based on ownership. The process is based on the quality of the physical resource. Many councils struggle with whether or not the process should be completely voluntary from an inventory standpoint versus from a designation standpoint. And that is something that you will have to carefully consider as to what the nature of the community is.
So are you saying that in certain instances or some cities have chosen, while you may not recommend it, but chosen to let homeowners opt out of the inventory?
In my experience, and I'm really thinking hard about this because we have a lot of experience, most cities choose to not let people opt out of the inventory because the inventory is the planning tool that compares like quality of resource to like quality of resource. Ordinances and designation procedures are entirely different. Some cities do not allow owners to opt out of a designation process. Some cities restrict their designation process to only owners and no one else. Some are most are in between.
But that's the way that it seems to be working at the moment.
To register a property on either national, California, or local level, does it require the owner's consent?
On the national register, it does. Mm-hmm. On the California, both the national register and the California register have a list of properties that have been designated that the owner concurs, and they have another list that's called the eligibility list, where the State Historic Resources Commission decides that the property meets the criteria, but the owner doesn't want it listed. So that goes on a list that tells a planner or someone else that that property might be eligible.
Yeah, but through the CEQA process, though, there might be requirements, even if a building is only eligible, should the owner want to do remodeling or addition.
Well, depending on the activity and whether or not it's discretionary in your city versus a mandatory action, and staff can speak to that if we want to take that time.
Okay.
Depending on whether or not you meet that threshold, then whether or not you meet the significance threshold could be a matter of discussion under CEQA. Most single family houses don't fall right under the realm of CEQA.
Correct. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you.
Well, we'll let the commission go first.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Well, for the Historic Resources Group, I'd like to say that I saw a lot of Native historic knowledge here, and hopefully they'll have a way to get in touch with you through Community Development Director Masura, or I see on the cover sheet here of your Historic Resources Survey, your contact info is there. So hopefully that'll be a future channel that Native knowledge in the community can be channeled to improve this process and better feed the robust dialogue that we've witnessed and that I anticipate will continue forward as the city and the residents and other folks, the commission, et cetera, and council clarify the historic preservation effort. With that, I'd like to ask if any commissioners have any comments or motions that they'd like to introduce. Hearing none, okay. Commissioner comments are concluded. Mr.
All
Mayor.
Right, thank you. Any further discussion from the City Council? Comments? Please, Council Member Bloom.
Yeah, I'd like to, I think this is a great first step. You know, as you said in the beginning, we had our 50th anniversary, an opportunity to look at this, to help us get our arms around of what do we have left in the city. We've talked about some stuff that's disappeared, some of the history. I think the Historical Society has probably documented a lot of that, but it's not physically here. So the question, you know, that you're bringing to us is you still have, and if I calculate the numbers, we got about 1%. You've talked about 10%. Yes, sorry about that. So we have about 1%. So I think we started the dialogue here tonight. The question in my mind still is, what value would all of this add to Temple City? And any additional guidelines or regulations or anything we have, how does that trade off with the value that it would bring to the city and I think to the citizens of the city? So I think the dialogue has started. I thank you for that. I thank staff for that. I know we got a grant to start this whole process. So, and I thank everybody for coming here today because this is what we wanted. We wanted people to come out and, you know, not come out and immediately oppose something, but let's look at what we've got and what we're trying to do, and let's get a dialogue going. So I thank everyone, and we don't have any Mount Vernon's here. We don't have Lincoln's, you know, birthplace here, but we have something here. And what is it, and is it something we want to do with it?
All right, thank you. Any other comments? Mayor Pro Tem, please.
Just one, when I'm thinking about the historical relevance to our city. I'm reminded of a quote that I came across, and it was an anonymous quote, and it stayed in my mind all these years that history is the navigator of where we've been and where we want to go. So I think it's important as a city and as representatives of the city of Temple City to actually, for, you know, our charge is to take a look at where we want to go. And individually, we need to ask that of ourselves. And I think we've started that most recently with looking at our history and putting a bust of Walter Temple in our park. So I think if we look at, you know, where we've been, and this history does have a great city, and where we'd like to go, I think that this survey is a great start. And it's going to be difficult, but it's 1% of what we have. 1% is not very much. And if we lose the 1%, I think in the big picture, what are we really giving up? So just my thoughts. And I thank you all for coming. I thank for the efforts of the staff and the people who brought the survey to us. It's a lot to think about.
Okay. Any other comments?
Well, I know it's been a long night, and I wasn't really going to say much, but that would be out of character for me, so I will say a few things. But I'll keep it quick. First of all, I want to thank HRG, of course, for their very informative report. I think it has educated all of us, I think, to a certain degree, and certainly I've learned a lot tonight, not only from the report, but even more importantly, I think, from all those in attendance. And again, I can't thank you enough for coming and participating in these types of events. I think if there's anything hopefully you've learned from this council is that, you know, we will listen. And this is the purpose of these types of meetings, to listen to your comments and take those back and use those in our decision-making process. I thought Howard raised a good point, however, and that is, you know, when do we really become concerned about preserving our history? You know, hopefully before it's too late. I keep thinking about, and I don't know why this came to my mind, but Winchell's Donuts. I don't know if any of you are familiar with the fact that, and I think this is true, that we had the first, Jerry, correct me if I'm wrong, the first Winchell's Donut ever, and it's no longer there. It's gone. So, and that's just one example, I think, of others that we could probably come up with. I'm sure our historical society members can raise other ones, too. So
the Winchell kids went to Temple City High School.
The Winchell kids went to Temple City High School. So there is a legacy out there. And, you know, we need to be aware of it. And so, you know, this is great. This is what we need to get those comments. So thank you again for coming. And you know, we'll keep you abreast of everything that comes along, and we hope that you keep participating. So thank you.
All right. Well, likewise, I thank everyone for participating. I thank our historic resource group for such a great presentation, such a great report, and staff also. I know they have participated and worked very hard with them. I'm not sure tonight is necessarily the night that, because it's really a lot to take in, a lot to read. And especially like Councilmember Chavez said, a lot of those comments are so important. I think it may take us a little time to digest that. So I don't know if any of the council members would like to propose a motion, but I can assure everyone that we're taking everything into consideration. It's important to preserve our heritage as we move forward to our next 50 year. But yet at the same time, we're not mindful of the fact that some of you may be concerned about loss of property value, maybe hard to get your house renovated or whatever. But I think some of those can be mitigated if we're careful about it. Should there be any should there be further resolution from the City Council or the Planning Commission on placing the historic survey on the adopting that, that will be on the future
Planning Commission and the City Council agenda. So please pay attention to our agenda that will be posted. It's gonna be on the city website. Anyone like to make a motion at this point? All right. So thank you again. We'll have more discussion on this topic, I'm sure. So meeting is adjourned. Good night, everyone.
Thank you.